Yes, ma'am, start.
Okay, good morning everyone. I am Dr. Anuradha, assistant professor in English, and today we'll start with the topic, what is communication, process of communication, barriers of communication, and various types of communication. So let's begin with the topic, what is communication? Communication is a Latin word which means in Latin to share. In Latin, communication means to share. Communication is taken from the Latin word communicare, communicare. So in Latin, when I said that communication means share, it means that whenever we share our feelings, our ideas, our knowledge, we communicate. Since the beginning, means since our birth, we communicate, and without communication, in fact, we cannot even imagine our life. Am I right? If some of you can give answers. Okay. Yes, it is very true that without communication, we cannot even imagine our lives. Communication, when I said, it has a process also. For example, as we make tea, right? We follow a correct process and only then we can have a delicious tea. Similarly, in communication also, we need to follow a process. Communication can be of two types. One is one-way communication and other is two-way communication. When I said that one-way communication, it means that the listener is passive listener and he cannot immediately respond to the things. For example, a newspaper. Newspaper is a one-way communication. The reader is reading and he can respond, of course, but through editorial messages only. He can write letter or he can write an email to the receiver. Am I right? Okay. So process of communication includes, of course, a sender and a receiver. Process of communication is, we need something, some components, or we can say some elements for communication. These elements are sender, encoder, or we can say encoding. Then we have message. We should also have channel, receiver, decoding, and feedback. So while we communicate, we need to understand this thing that the main important component of communication is sender. Now, sender, who is sender? The one who will send the message. Sender has to include the message, means he has to decide.
नेट की प्रॉब्लम हो सकती है, इसलिए सभी इंतजार करेंगे। जी मैम।
यस, sorry because it is due to technical issue that by chance I was deleting something. Okay, so we were at the process of communication. When I said that the process of communication is very important, means if we want to communicate effectively and if we want that our listeners or our receivers, they should receive the message as we perceive or as we want to want them to perceive, so we need to follow a proper process. For that we need sender, encoding, means sender is one who sends the message. Encoding means he has to encode what he or she wants to convey to his or her receiver. Then a message should be there, means communication should be with a purpose. So your message should be very, very clear. it should not be ambiguous. You should have a purpose or aim of communication. And when the sender has decided that he will send a message to the receiver, the next component, the fourth component, is channel. Channel is very important because communicator or the sender needs to understand that which channel is appropriate to send the message. For example, if we want to convey something which is urgent in a college, what we do? We display the same thing on the notice board. But we know that many times students even do not go to notice board. Then what we will do? We'll say to teachers that kindly convey the message to students personally whenever you will go to class. So kindly tell them that there is a competition, for example. And to our boss, for example, if we have to send a message, what we will do? We always think that email is an official record. So we choose a channel that is email to convey to our bosses, right? So the choice of channel is very, very important. The only channel can decide that your message has been conveyed properly or it has not been conveyed. Right? For example, for an urgent message, either we will call the person by telephone or we'll go ourselves. So urgent messages need to be conveyed immediately. That's, thus, channel is quite important. Then the next important component of communication is receiver. Receiver means who receives the message, right? Receiver has an important role in communication. As sender is an active component, receiver is also an active component. Receiver cannot be a passive component. Though he is just or she is just receiving a message, but the way he is receiving, definitely it improves the quality of communication. Thus, what the receiver has to do while communicating, he has to decode the message. So, as sender encodes the message, receiver has to decode the message and he has to give the feedback too. Thus, we have done the process of communication. Process of communication includes sender. He has to encode a message. There should be a message. There should be a purpose for the communication. Then receiver receives the message. He has to decode it and give the feedback. And the feedback will be received by the sender and the communication will be complete. Without feedback, communication cannot be completed. Thus, feedback is quite important. So, the process and elements of communication are of different types. Though there are many kinds of communication, we'll discuss here a few kinds of communication. One is downwards communication, second is upwards communication, and horizontal communication. In an organization, basically, there are three types of communication. When we communicate in an organization, either we communicate in downwards way, or we communicate upwards, or we communicate horizontal. Now, what is downwards communication? Downwards communication means when the message floats from down to up, it is known as downwards communication. For example, in an organization, if an employee is there and he wants to say some message to his manager, then the manager conveys the same message to the deputy manager and the deputy manager conveys the same message to the senior manager. Senior manager conveys the message to the MD, managing director. Then it will be known as downwards communication. For example, in a college, if a student wants to convey a message, he can convey through her or his teacher. For example, if a student conveys a message to the teacher conveys the same message to the head of the department, and head of the department conveys the same message to principal. That means it is a downwards communication. Downward communication is quite important for the success of an organization because if there will not be any downward communication, the boss, the managing directors, or the senior most persons in organization will not be able to understand the problems or the barriers the other people are following, right? I hope the downwards communication is clear to you. Second one is upwards communication. Upwards communication means when the message flows from up to down, it is called upwards communication. For example, a principal wants to give a message. In a college, a principal will give it to head of the department. The head of the department will give convey the same message to the teachers, and the teachers will convey the same message to students. In an organization, managing director, he wants to convey a message to the managing director conveys the message to director, then director to deputy director, deputy director to the other to other members of the team. It will be known as upwards communication. And the next is horizontal communication. When I say horizontal communication, horizontal communication means when the communication is at a level. For example, there are two managing directors in a company. There are two directors in a company of different departments, right? In a college, there can be various head of the department. For example, head of the department of English, head of the department of mathematics, head of the department of Hindi. When the person at the same designation, they convey the message to each other, that is known as horizontal communication. I hope the horizontal communication is clear to you. You can ask me the questions, you can note down and ask me later. So I hope this type of communication is clear to you. So let's proceed further. Next is written communication versus oral communication. You know, students, there are basically two types of communication. One is verbal communication and the another is non-verbal communication. Though it will come in different unit, but still I'll explain it to you. In verbal communication, words are there. When words include in a communication, it is known as verbal communication. And non-verbal communication means when words does not include at all. So verbal communication is of two kinds. One is written communication and the other is oral communication. And non-verbal communication includes body language, gestures, proxemics, kinesics, and another things. We'll discuss it later. Now I explain to you what is written communication and what is oral communication. Written communication and oral communication, if I tell you through a tree chart, they are the part of verbal communication. Written communication, as the name suggests, is conveyed through words written on something. For example, if you email to someone, it is a part of written communication. When we read newspaper, it is a part of written communication. When you answer your papers, when you write your papers, it is a part of written communication. So written communication means when you convey your message through written mode. And if we revise the process of communication, in it channel goes there, and in channel the sender has to decide that he has to follow written communication or oral communication. If the message is urgent, we usually believe that oral communication is most fast than the written communication. Okay, so next is oral communication. Oral communication means when we speak. We convey our message through speech, it is called oral communication. Examples of written communication are email, newspapers, magazines. And examples of oral communication are media, TV news, for example, news. Okay, telephone, when we give someone a call, it is a part of oral communication. I hope it is clear. Now, you know, students, when we communicate, there are many barriers. Barriers means the obstacles we face while communicating. So when I say that barriers are again an important part of communication and we need to understand these barriers, I mean to say that communication should be effective. If a sender wants to communicate something to the receiver and the receiver has received the message as it is, as the sender has given, only then the communication will be effective communication. Otherwise, communication can be ineffective. Communication is very important. It means when we share our feelings, our ideas with others, we communicate. Okay. So there are various barriers of communication. The first barrier of communication I would like to discuss here is code. Okay, when I have done process of communication, I have told you the first component of communication is sender and he has to encode a message. When I say that the barriers of communication is code, so encoding and code, both has a connection. Now, for example, I want to communicate something with you, but I am not using the proper language. Proper language means I am from a state which is where most of the people speak Hindi, and you are from the state where nobody speaks in Hindi at all. So you cannot, what I want to tell you, you won't be able to understand. So coding is important. Coding, the sender has to keep this thing in mind that the code must be same of the sender as well as of the receiver. Code is a barrier. If a sender uses a wrong code, then the receiver can not receive it properly and then the communication will be ineffective. Second is vocabulary. Okay, we have the same language. We have done that the code is a barrier of communication, and we have done this thing that, okay, we will follow the same code, means same language. Then comes the vocabulary. You know, suppose I speak in Hindi and I'm from Haryana. You are from other state, for example, Uttar Pradesh or Bihar or any of the states where Hindi is the first language to be speak, where most of the people speak Hindi. So vocabulary, you know what? We have many ambiguous words. For example, if I say the word beer, it has many meanings. Beer is a animal also, for example, bhalu, right? Beer means to tolerate something. I cannot bear the pain, for example. Then bear means to lift something. I cannot bear so much weight, or I cannot bear the weight of my father's death, for example. So bear is a word which has many meanings, and thus we can say that it is an ambiguous word if we are trying to convey message through the word bear. The receiver can take any of the meaning which will suit him. Thus, vocabulary is a great barrier to communication. Thus, we should always keep this thing in mind that we should not use jargons. Jargons means the local words which we use. There are many jargons of a company, there of organizations. There are many jargons which people follow in some locality, but globally they don't follow that. So while choosing vocabulary, we should keep this thing in mind that we should have a simple language. We should not use ambiguous words. We should not use jargons. Right. The third is background knowledge and shared assumptions. Now, when I say that you need to communicate effectively, and thus you need to understand the background, the knowledge, and the shared assumptions of the receiver. Background means, for example, there can be many things. There can be cultural problems, there can be physical problems, etc. And so we should always think that when we are communicating our message to someone, we should have a knowledge of the background of that person so that we can convey effectively. Next is pronunciation. Pronunciation is very, again, very important. If we pronounce the word correctly, definitely we will be able to convey our message effectively. If we are not pronouncing the words correctly, then the other person may not get our message. Thus, pronunciation is again a great barrier to communication. Next is intonation. Now, what is intonation? It comes in the category of paralanguage. Paralanguage means language beyond language. When I say that intonation is quite important, it means that means when we communicate with someone, we need to raise our voice or we need to lower our voice, right? So there is rising tone as well as falling tone when we communicate with others. When I say that intonation is quite important, then you may say, ma'am, what is important in the intonation when we are communicating? What does the mean? We means the word. Intonation can miscommunicate. For example, okay, let me give an example. Stop, don't go. Okay, stop, don't go. The three words are the same, but the intonation of in first sentence I have used the intonation at stop, don't go. I am stressing that you should stop, you should not go. But when I say stop, don't, or don't stop, go, right, then of course this means that you need to go. So intonation is quite important. Many times you may have told to your parents, to your siblings, to your offsprings maybe, that use the proper tone. I'll do your work only when you will use the proper tone. So it means that tone and the pitch, they of course play a very important role in our lives. Thus, whenever we communicate, we should be very, very careful about the intonation. It means the tone in which we are speaking to the other person. It should not be very harsh. It should not be very low. Of course, it should be pleasing. Even the person is not able to see you, he should understand from your tone that you are in a happy mood. Only then the your communication will be effective. Okay, then the next barrier of communication is physical barrier. Now, what is physical barrier? Basically, it is a distance barrier, we can say. For example, you are in one city and the communicator or the sender is in another city. So what way he will convey you the message? He may give you a phone call. Okay, you are at a phone call and suddenly a noise come and you are not able to understand the message, and then the phone cuts. What will happen? There will be ineffective communication, because you won't be able to understand that what is going on, or what the other person has said, or maybe you just perceive it that you just perceive that this person may have said this thing in this context and you may do according to that. But again, when the communication happens, you may feel that it is a ineffective communication. So physical barrier is quite important. Though nowadays technology is quite advanced, and physical barrier is not that much, you know, significant in communication, but still physical, if you are not interacting face to face, there can be many misunderstandings, there can be many things which can give you ineffective communication. For example, you need to understand that what is communication. For example, if there is a meeting and someone is saying Mr. Gupta is not coming. Okay, when I say Mr. Gupta is not coming, the meaning of this sentence, if I say literally, then it is quite easy to understand that what can be the meaning of this sentence, Mr. Gupta is not coming. But when I say that Mr. Gupta is not coming, the persons who are attending the meeting, they can have different meaning of this sentence. For example, Mr. Gupta may be the MD of the company. So if he is not coming, there will be no meeting at all. Maybe the Mr. Gupta is the key speaker. in some conference or some seminar. So if I say that Mr. Gupta is not coming, it means you have to change your schedule according to that. If I say that Mr. Gupta is not coming, so maybe he has all the presentations, and without him, it means that you cannot have the meeting. So because you do not have the presentation, so you need to understand this thing that whenever you communicate with someone, there are two meanings of one thing. One is literal meaning and the another is literal meaning. So when I say to you that Mr. Gupta is not coming, it may have various meanings. Of course, the literal meaning is very easy to understand. It means that Mr. Gupta won't be able to attend the meeting. But on the other side, it can be that it can be like without him, even there can be no meeting at all. He is a very important person, or he is the key speaker, or he is the MD, he is the managing director, or he is the key speaker in a conference. So you need to change your schedule according to that. So students, let's recapitulate the things. First thing we have done, what is communication? Communication is taken from the Latin word communi. Here, communicare. When I say communicare in Latin, it means to share. Thus, what is communication? Communication means to share our feelings, our ideas, our knowledge. Right? When I say that we can share our feelings, our ideas, our knowledge with others, it means we can understand the feelings and ideas and knowledge of others too. In communication can be of two types: one-way communication and two-way communication. Two-way communication means when the sender and the receiver both are present, and in one-way communication when the receiver is an active is not an active receiver, he is passive receiver at that time, though later he can convey his message. For example, you are listening to a news and you do not like that news, you can be a passive listener at that time. But later you can email, you can call, you can send an SMS to that news channel. Or even, in fact, if you want, you can even complain to the news broadcaster, casting agencies too. So when I say that, it means that communication always includes a sender and a receiver. There is a process of communication. Process of communication has basically some components. First component and the very most important component is sender. Sender is the one who sends the message. Thus, he has to encode. He has to encode a message too, and thus we call him encoder too. He has to understand what he wants to send. Then he has to decide the message, the purpose of the message, the aim of the message, and thus he has to decide from which channel he will send the message. Channel is very important for the sender. Why? Because you know what? You need to decide that whether your message is urgent or it is not urgent. According to that, you will decide the channel. For example, you want your friend to come at your home. What you will do? You may give him her a phone call, and the sister picks the calls and she says, no, my brother is not here, I'll convey the message to him. But you want that he should be there. So what you will say, okay, please convey him also, and please tell him to give me a call. Okay, so it means that you have decided a channel, you will give a phone call. If it is quite important, you may also go to your friend's home to give the message that we need to sit together and we need to do this project, we need to complete it as it is quite urgent. So channel is very important. Until and unless you do not follow a proper channel, you won't be able to convey your message properly. Then in process of communication, the most important component is receiver. Receiver is never a passive receiver. He has to play an active receiver. Activeness should be there. Means he should understand the message same as given by the sender. Thus, he need to decode a message, and he is also called a decoder. So after decoding the message or after sending receiving the message, he has to give feedback also, because if the receiver will not give the feedback, the sender will not be able to understand that whether the message has been conveyed properly or it has not been conveyed properly. Right? So process of communication is very important. There are various types of communication. One is downwards communication. Downwards communication means when the message flow from down to up, it is called downwards communication. For example, in a college, if a student gives the message to her class teacher, then the class teacher gives the message to the head of the department, and the same message has been conveyed to the director, to the principal, or to the vice chancellor, whosoever is senior to that head of the department, then it will be known as downwards communication. In downwards communication, in an organization, when an employee or the team member gives the message to his team leader, then the same message will be conveyed to the director, then the deputy director will convey the same message to the managing director. It will be known as upwards communication. Okay, when horizontal communication, when I say horizontal communication, means when the people of the same designation, they communicate with each other, it is known as horizontal communication. For example, head of the department of mathematics, head of the department of English, head of the department of Hindi, when they convey a message to each other, it will be a horizontal message. In a company, for example, deputy director purchase, deputy director sales, deputy director planning, when they will communicate an official message to each other, it will be known as horizontal communication. Okay. So let's start with the another type of communication, that is written versus oral communication. To understand written and oral communication, we need to understand that there are two types of communication. One is verbal communication and the another is non-verbal communication. Verbal communication, when I say, it means it includes words, and non-verbal communication means it does not include words at all. So when I say that verbal communication includes words, it is of two types. One is written communication and the another one is oral communication. For example, now I am communicating with you is an example of oral communication. Okay, if thus in the same way if I'll send you notes, then it will be a kind of written communication. So written communication is quite important. For example, newspapers are the best example of written communication. We read the newspaper and we understand the message on our own. Sometimes you know what, a reader, as I told you in barriers, that there is a background of the reader, then the knowledge of the reader. Some in when you are reading a newspaper, you may understand that some of the topics you may perceive it in a different way, and your father may perceive it in a different way because he has a different background. Generation gap may be there, or he has a different kind of knowledge, and your knowledge can be less or more. So both of you may read the same piece of newspaper, the same piece of news, but you may perceive the news in a different way. So written communication, again, it will depend on the receiver that how he or she wants to perceive it. Next type of communication is oral communication. When I say oral communication, it means when we speak something and we convey our message through spoken words, it is known as oral communication. For example, if you watch news, if you listen news, you watch YouTube channels, or you watch, you are here on Google Meet. So it is a kind of oral communication. I hope the communication part is clear to you. So let's start now. Barriers of communication. Barriers means When we communicate with someone, many times we try to communicate something, but the other person, he understands something else. And this is always due to the barriers in communication. Barriers in communication, we need to understand that the barriers are quite important. And until and unless we are not able to eradicate these barriers from our communication, we won't be able to communicate effectively. When we want to communicate effectively, we should always work over on these barriers, which I am telling you. First barrier, we had discussed also, that is code. The sender who is encoder, he need to understand in which, what code he will follow. It means what language he will follow, the language of the sender as well as the receiver should be same. Only then they will be able to understand. Yes, Muskan? Anything you want to say? Muskan? Because you are flashing again and again on your on my screen, so you want to say something?
Ma'am, आप continue करिए और जो question answer से वो बच्चे से बाद में discussion करेंगे.
All right, sir. All right. Because that girl is flashing on my screen, na, that's why I asked. Okay, students. Let's begin with the barriers. Code. Code. Maybe the same. Code should be followed same by the receiver as well as the sender. Then we have discussed vocabulary. In vocabulary, I have told you that there are many words in English which has various meanings. One which has more than two meanings, more than one meaning, or we can say. So ambiguous words means which has the various meanings. We should not use them. We should not use jargons. We should not use cliches when we are speaking to someone, the one who is not much familiar with us. In official communication, or in we can say formal communication, we should try to understand that the vocabulary should be very much clear. It should be simple, and the receiver should be able to understand what we want to convey. Then the most important barrier when we communicate with someone is that is background. We need to understand the background or the knowledge or the shared assumptions of the receiver. You know, until and unless we do not know the shared assumption. Shared assumptions means we assume something. So this assumption may be very difficult for all of us to understand that. It may sometimes lead to miscommunication. Thus, we should try to understand the background as well as the knowledge of the receiver. Because you know what? If suppose we are sharing a knowledge with someone, and that person is quite, you know, he is quite young to you. You cannot tell them each and everything. And for example, to a small baby of 5 to 6 years, you cannot share the knowledge which is actually of no use to him. So thus, you need to understand the background and the knowledge of your receiver. There is one element of communication which is quite necessary. That is equality. It means that when the sender is giving the message to the receiver, he should consider himself equal to the receiver. Only then the effective message can be given. Next is pronunciation. Of course, if we pronounce the wrong word, or we can say that if we use the wrong accent, definitely there can be miscommunication. Thus, before speaking, we should understand that we need to learn the pronunciation of that particular word. For that, we can use Oxford Dictionary. For that, we can use Google also. So, pronunciation should be very clear to the person who is listening to you. And then the intonation. Intonation is very important. Most of the times you say, Okay, I won't do his work. He is not my boss, for example. Or even to your brother, your sister, you say, I won't do your work because you have chosen the wrong tone. Okay, you have tried to order me. Sometimes it happens at your home too. So when we are communicating with others, we should always keep the tone in our mind. It is a kind of para language. Para language means language beyond language. When we convey our message to the receiver, we should always be very careful for the tone as well as for the pitch. Then the another barrier is cultural specific. You know, culture specific. How I can tell you this? I can give you an example for this. In Dubai, Sir Fexel thought, it's a real story actually. It's Sir Fexel thought that okay, we'll introduce our product there as it is quite successful in India. So I think that there also it can be very successful. So they have launched their company without communicating with the cultural communicator. So you know, in India, what we do, we read from where, from left to right, but in Urdu speaking countries, they usually they read from left to sorry, right to left. So what happened? They have displayed a board, and what has happened there? There was a bucket of dirty clothes, then there was a Surf Excel, and then there was a bucket of clean clothes. So what happened? There was no sale at all of Surf Excel there. So they thought something wrong may have done. So they had talked cultural communicator. He came there and he told that the display board you have done wrong because your product says that if you dip clean clothes into the Surf Excel bucket, into the bucket of Surf Excel, they'll come unclean. So it means you are giving a wrong message. And immediately they have changed all the display boards, and there was a huge sale in Surf Excel. So we need to understand the culture of others also before speaking. Only then we will be able to convey our message clearly. When I say that cultural specific, it means we need to understand that what things are not accepted in a particular culture, we should try to learn that also. So next is physical barrier. Physical barrier is again an important aspect of communication. When I say physical barrier, it means distance. Basically, it means distance. For example, in your home too, if you are shouting from one room to and you want to convey your message to the another room, so you need to shout it many times. For example, you want to say that switch off the fan. They may understand many things before switching off the fan, and of course, you will not feel good about that. So what you need to understand, you need to understand this thing that physical barriers should be taken care of. Whenever there is a physical barrier, you should try to, do it. You should try to clear it. For example, if you are calling someone and you have made a call, and again there is a noise, and then there is definitely the disturbance. Disturbance may cause miscommunication. So today we have discussed communication, process of communication, types of communication, and barriers of communication. I am open for question and answers. There are 10 minutes, still 10 minutes. You can ask me questions.
अपने माइक को अनम्यूट करके कोई अगर कुछ पूछना चाहता है मैम से तो उनसे वार्तालाप कर सकता है।
यू कैन आस्क मी द क्वेश्चन. आप कुछ भी पूछना चाहते हैं तो आप पूछ सकते हैं. आई विल क्लियर दैट.
continue.
Okay, then the next one more type of communication I would like to tell you, that is formal communication and informal communication. When I say that formal communication, this type is clear, formal communication. It means when we are in our office, when we are in our organization, and when we are talking with someone, that is known as formal communication. Informal communication means when we are talking with our friends, with our family, that is known as informal communication. So the question arises, can there be informal communication? In a informal communication too, in a formal setting, for example, two colleagues are there and they are discussing, which is not related to the office talk, office communication, then it will be a informal communication. Similarly, in an informal setting you can have a formal communication? Yes, if suppose someone is at your home and he or she is your colleague and you are in informal setting, but again you want to discuss something which is related to the office, which is related to office work, then it can be formal communication. But what is the basic difference in formal communication and informal communication? Formal communication always have a purpose, and informal communication may be without a purpose too. So I think this type of communication is also clear to you. Any other thing you want to ask me? I'm done with my lecture. If you want to ask me, you can ask.
रुचि मोहन अपना प्रेजेंटेशन स्टॉप करें. रुचि मोहन अपना जो जो प्रेजेंटिंग है उसको स्टॉप करें. ओके मैम कंटिन्यू.
ओके सो till now we have done what is communication, process of communication, barriers to communication, and types of communication. So let's begin with the next part, that is verbal communication and non-verbal communication. Verbal communication, as I told you, is the communication which includes words, right? So it is of two types. One is written communication and the other is oral communication. Now, so what is non-verbal communication? Non-verbal communication means which does not include words. So if it does not include words, what will it include? Of course, yes, the body language. It will include proxemics. Four types of non-verbal communication are there: proxemics, kinesics, and physical communication, and paralanguage. Okay, let's discuss proxemics. Let's discuss body language first. Body language is very important. We all have various, we all need to understand this thing, that when we talk with someone, we need to be very careful about the body language, means about the gestures, about the postures. Gestures can be of various types. For example, if I use this gesture, this gesture means very good, okay, or if you are eating something and someone has asked that how is the taste, and you say so it means it is a gesture which is actually positive gesture. But again, this gesture means it can be a negative gesture too. It means because it is showing zero, right? So when I say that it is saying zero, it means it is a negative gesture. For example, someone has asked you that how was my presentation, and you say it means you have not done good, right? So we should be very careful that what kind of gestures we are using. For example, this gesture, this is thumbs up, right? So in thumbs up, when I say thumbs up means you have done a good job, right? But again, this gesture is saying we used to irritate it to our siblings, to our friends also, this gesture. Okay, there is no substance at all, for example, if you say to someone. So again, this gesture can be positive, and again, this gesture can be negative too. So thus, whenever you are using any gesture, you should be very clear that what kind of gesture you are using, whether it conveys only the positive message or it can convey a negative message too, right? So this gesture I have told you, this gesture I have told you. Then this gesture, of course, it always conveys a negative gesture. So you are very clear that whenever you thumbs down, when it is a negative gesture. Okay. So positive gestures are very important to use when you are talking with someone, but they should not be ambiguous at all. Then if I talk about posture, so I can show you one minute. For example, this, right? Cross hands, cross arms, cross legs, they all are negative postures. Whenever you talk with someone, do not cross your hands, do not cross your legs, do not cross your arms. Though this one, we feel comfortable in this, but actually this posture conveys that you are not confident at all. So thus, while talking with someone, you need to understand this thing, that what kind of posture you need to follow, right? Then again, when in body language, your face is of course very important. Your face should be no touch zone, because it again, if you will touch your face again, it will show that you are showing negative gestures to someone. It means that you are showing less confidence. For example, this, when you sit like this, it shows that you are not interested at all. Though usually in class, most of the students sit like this, and I say that, are you feeling bored? And then they say, no ma'am, we are sitting comfortable. But it shows lack of confidence. So your face is no touch zone. You should not, your hairs are no touch zone. ऐसे ऐसे आपको you need not to do this. ऐसे ऐसे आपको अपने बालों को नहीं टच करना है. It gives a wrong message, right? Then fidgeting of hands, you should not fidget your hands, your fingers whenever you talk to someone, because again it shows a negative gesture. Okay. Then in body language, eyes, eye contact is very important. When I say eye contact means you should not stare at all. Staring should not be there. But eye contact should be there. Earlier, people used to say there, even to us also, our parents has told that you should not, you should down your eyes whenever you are looking at someone who is elder to you. But nowadays, eye contact is very important. If we do not, if we are not able to establish a proper eye contact with our receiver, definitely it shows that we are not confident at all. Eye contact should be there, of course, but staring should not be there. You should not stare at the person regularly. You should keep this thing in mind that whenever you are talking to someone, you should have an eye-to-eye contact with that person, so that a person can have, the one who is receiving your message can have the confidence that whatever you are speaking right. So eye contact is again very important, right? So we have discussed gestures, posture, and facial expressions. Facial expressions, frowning of eyes should not be there. Then the eyes are the mirrors of our soul, of course, and smile should be there. Gandhiji says that until and unless you do not wear a smile, you are not completely dressed. It means that smile should be there always on your face, which shows your confidence. So whenever you are with someone to whom you are meeting first time, you should smile. You should not laugh, right? But time to time, you should give a proper smile. Smile is quite important because whenever you smile, you give a comfort zone to your receiver, the one who is receiving your message or the one who is listening. You definitely you are giving a comfort zone to that person, and he may or she may feel good in your company. Thus, while speaking to someone, you should have a proper eye contact. You should use proper gestures. You should use proper postures also, and smile should be there. One more thing I want to include here in gestures, that most of the times people do like this. People do like this, or people sometimes do like this. It means that you are not comfortable with your receiver. It means that it shows that you are not interested at all in your talk. So it always gives a wrong signal to the one who is giving a message to you. Thus, you should not give wrong signals to your speaker, right? You should always try to understand this thing, that your speaker may give you many things until and unless you are not giving the wrong signals to that person. Right, then yawning should not be there. Yawning is quite bad. It of course it breaks the confidence of the speaker. So we have done this thing. If you want to ask something, you can ask me. We are done with our lecture, sir. If any student can ask, they can ask.
विद्यार्थी पूछना चाहते हैं तो वो अपना माइक अनम्यूट कर लें और चर्चा कर सकते हैं। अनिल खान, आप कुछ पूछना चाहेंगे? अंजलि, मुस्कान, ओके जी मैम, आपकी तरफ से कुछ है?
No, sir. I am done with my lecture. If you can, if you want to say something, you can say. Any of you, Anjali, Muskan, or Manir Khan, if you have understood the lecture, so give a thumbs up. Or if you want to ask something, you can ask.
Okay, ma'am.
Okay, sir. I think you are clear with the things.
सभी विद्यार्थियों की जानकारी के लिए बता देते हैं कि इग्नो रीजनल सेंटर चंडीगढ़ असाइनमेंट सिर्फ गूगल फॉर्म के माध्यम से स्वीकार कर रहा है। आप कृपया किसी भी ईमेल आईडी के ऊपर अपनी असाइनमेंट ना भेजें। हमने एक गूगल फॉर्म जनरेट किया हुआ है जो आरसी चंडीगढ़ की वेबसाइट के ऊपर उपलब्ध है और उसकी जानकारी फेसबुक पेज के ऊपर भी उपलब्ध है। आप उसका प्रयोग कर अपनी जितनी भी असाइनमेंट है उनको पीडीएफ फॉर्म में कन्वर्ट करके उसके ऊपर अपलोड करें और असाइनमेंट एक के बाद एक अपलोड करनी है। अगर आपके पांच असाइनमेंट हैं तो आपको पांच बार अलग अलग तरीके से उनको अपलोड करना है। जब आप फॉर्म के माध्यम से अपनी असाइनमेंट अपलोड करेंगे तो आपको प्रत्येक असाइनमेंट की एक फॉर्म रिसीव आपके ईमेल आईडी के ऊपर आएगी, उसको आप संभाल के रखेंगे। ये मेरी तरफ से जानकारी थी। अगर फिर भी कोई बच्चा किसी भी प्रकार का अन्य कोई क्षेत्रीय केंद्र से संबंधित प्रश्न पूछना चाहता है तो मैं यहाँ पे उपलब्ध हूँ उनके उत्तर देने के लिए।
ओके सर,
जैसे असाइनमेंट बना,
जी मनीर बोलो।
यस
जो असाइनमेंट बना के जमा कराने हैं वो नहीं कराने सर, वैसे मेल ही करने हैं।
मनीर, आपने शायद अभी असाइनमेंट भेजी थी ना अभी थोड़ी देर पहले?
हाँ जी, हाँ जी, ली थी जी।
आपने आरसी चंडीगढ़ की वेबसाइट पे भेजी है शायद अभी आपने?
मैंने सर नहीं, अभी तो नहीं भेजी सर।
आपने जो असाइनमेंट बनानी है उनको पीडीएफ फॉर्म में कन्वर्ट करके और जो हमने लिंक करवाया हुआ है उस लिंक के माध्यम से एक एक असाइनमेंट अपलोड करनी है। किसी भी ईमेल पे भेजने की आवश्यकता नहीं है, ये विशेष रूप से नोट करना।
ठीक है जी, वैसे पीडीएफ बना के सेंड करनी है बस।
अभी आपने मांगा है लिंक तो मैं अभी लिंक शेयर कर रहा हूँ।
ठीक है सर,
मिलेगा भी
कर दो।
हेलो
बोलिए बोलिए।
सर, माय क्वेश्चन इज कि जो असाइनमेंट है उसकी लास्ट डेट मेरे को पूछनी थी, और ये पूछना था कि ऑनलाइन ही सबमिट कर सकते हैं या फिर फाइल वगैरह बना के, जैसे जहाँ पे मीटिंग वगैरह होती है कॉलेज में, ये वहाँ पे करनी है। वैसे तो लॉकडाउन है, बट फिर भी आप मेरे को बता सकते हो तो।
असाइनमेंट आपको 31 मई तक आप जमा करा सकते हैं।
31 मार्च
मुझे लिंक मैंने अभी आपके चैट बॉक्स में डाल दिया है, इन लिंक के माध्यम से आप उसको अपलोड कर सकते हैं।
तो सर वो पीडीएफ बना के आप।
असाइनमेंट तैयार नहीं है तो आप असाइनमेंट को बना के रख सकते हैं। जैसे लॉकडाउन खुलेगा तो आप अपने स्टडी सेंटर पर भी उसको जमा करा सकते हैं। ठीक
ठीक है सर, ठीक है,
है,
ओके सर,
ओके सर। और
थैंक
सर मेरे को ये, जैसे कि मैं,
यू।
मैंने आफ्टर 10 मिनट जो मीटिंग ज्वाइन की है, 10 मिनट के बाद, तो इसका फर्स्ट टॉपिक कम्युनिकेशन ही था, इससे पहले भी आपने करवाया कोई मतलब।
इसकी पूरी वीडियो अभी 15 से 20 मिनट के बाद फेसबुक पेज के ऊपर उपलब्ध होगी। एनीवन
फेसबुक पे सर, इसी के नाम से आर सी चंडीगढ़ के नाम से,
हाँ इंडिविजुअल सेंटर के नाम से जो हमारा फेसबुक
सर आप
है।
इस पे
ओके
लिंक
मैम, थैंक
प्रोवाइड करोगे?
यू। किसका लिंक चाहिए आपको?
सर आपने बोला ना फेसबुक से पेड डालेंगे आप,
व्यक्ति हैं आपको हमारा फेसबुक पेज तो जरूर पता होना चाहिए, तो उसको लाइक करके रखो। मैंने शेयर कर दिया, अभी चेक कर लीजिए चैट बॉक्स में। ओके, घर में रहें, सुरक्षित रहें। थैंक यू मैम।
ओके सर, थैंक यू, स्टे होम।
थैंक यू।